We do bless you all and greetings in the precious name of Yeshua HaMashiach, you that have joined us via the live broadcast for Kit Ve'imat, simply that we open up and expose the depths of Torah, that it become a reality in our minds and the principles of our lives. There are so many philosophical ideas and concepts in life. I was pondering that today and I said it leads to nothing. It is simply a rush of information that one collects, and one takes from that assortment of information, and that is what establishes the ability to process things and to determine what kind of individual that one is. What the Torah teaches us and shows us, the complete one that is in Yeshua HaMashiach. And so there is no philosophy in life that exceeds the dynamics of the truth of Yah. I want to teach a simple teaching tonight. Many times in my labor, my mind is constantly pondering what the book says. And I want to teach from these two words, from above. And we know that if it is from, it is the origin of a concept, a thought, an idea. That's what the word from means. It is the origin, the beginning of that concept, that idea. But when we deal with the word above, when we began to understand the depth of that word from above, hallelujah, it has a much more profound definitive than from. It is marum. It is of dignity. It is dignified. It is exalted. It is of great strength and character. And so I want to teach that which is from above. It is important to understand that, because if it is from above, it is beyond the concept, the thought process of man to analyze it, because he is beneath. So he has no ability to interpret that. And the only way he can, we must follow the process of Torah that we may get understanding of how we process that and how it is interpreted from the mind that originated it, that we may draw from the wealth of that. Wisdom is a great thing to apprehend and to have, but without understanding of wisdom, you have nothing at all. You must understand the depths of wisdom, the ability, the power, and the riches of wisdom in order to imply or apply the principles of wisdom to one's daily walk before Almighty God. And so the things that are in this book, they are from above. I want to begin in this teaching, hallelujah, that we may understand the concept of above, the heights of it, the depths of its height. It is far beyond our reach. It is far beyond our ability to ascertain or to attain. So there must be one that has the power to give us that wisdom and ability to not only obtain, but to attain, that we reach the level of understanding and wisdom that we may comprehend that which is greater in any quality or quantity, and the degree of what we knew yesterday is greater today, because the knowledge of that becomes more fruitful as we apply it to our lives and allow the working of that to work in us the excellence of Almighty Yahweh. Once we began to do that, then we began to see the productivity and the great proliferation of us and our confidence in Him, that we will trust Him greatly. I do want to give us a few ketuv concerning the concept of what is above. David speaks so profoundly here in Tehillim, in Psalms 113 and verse 5. He asked the question, who? identify the being or thing, those that, who is like, who has the resemblance and the same prototype as Almighty Yahweh. Who is like Almighty Yahweh, our Abba? There is no other like him, because his image, his thoughts are far above what we see in the creative realm, Yisrael. Who is like Yah our Abba? He tells us that he, Yashab, that he dwells. Not only does he dwell, but he remains. He abides in the heavens above, that we have no knowledge of the depth, the breadth, the width of the heavens that we see above. He said that he abides on high. In essence, he abides Marown. He abides, he lives in majesty. And our minds, when we began to understand the greatness of his majesty, then there is where the appreciation began to flow from us. And not only that, but it resonates, it flows with a continuous flow when we realize who he is and where he is, because he is above, he is high, he sits high, Israel, and he looks low, because we are a lowly people. To give us some kind of variance or some kind of cognate concept as to how he sits, well, David gives us that in Psalms 103. Tehillim 103 and verse 11. Tehillim 103 verse 11. He says, "For as Hashemayim, or the heavens, is high above." The heavens are high above. It is greater than the knowledge of the degree that we can compute, as to say how far the heavens are. I said one day, and I think on this, how far our natural eyes can see. So if the sun is 93 million miles away, then certainly I can see 93 million miles. Now that's a fact. So he gives us an analogy, a scenario, that as far as the heavens from the earth, so great is the power of his chassid, his steadfast love kindness, toward who? Toward us that fear him. We understand his perch, his place, his position, his authority, that it caused us to tremble in his presence. There is a yira, it is a fear of great reverence. It is a fear of his great power, his strength, and his beauty. It is a fear of his omnipresence before us, as we see in all things that are created. So if we can measure, if we can give a quantitative, numeric association with the height of the earth and the heavens, then we can understand the greatness of that kind of a hava that is above. Now this stuff we call love, ahava, it is filthy. It is of no value, it has no substance at all, Yisrael. I am the type that when I began a job or anything, I ponder out every aspect, how it's done, what it's going to take. And so Zachin Benjamin and I, we were doing the greenhouse yesterday at temperatures of 111 degrees. And it was hot. And so the first bed in the greenhouse, I had taken all of the containers that were there. I had taken them inside and I had put all that in the greenhouse raised bed. So from that moment, I began to understand what it will take to do all the beds. I knew exactly how much I put from years back, how much we put in those containers, and how much it took to fill them. I knew exactly what it would take to fill a greenhouse. I knew exactly how many, because that's how I think when I work. I enjoy work So when I work, I ponder the process, so the next time that I know how long, or I can state a numeric order there that I can equate with what I am about to do. I know exactly how many shovels of dirt we used yesterday. I didn't have to count all of them, but believe me, I know exactly how many shovels of that dirt. I know that's difficult for us to believe, but I ponder things, the greatest of his depths, the simplest of his form, and he that is above, because we are trying to equate him or trying to describe him with this collage of all kinds of verbiage that has been created in our minds, and it's not worth a dime, any of it. And so that's how we visualize him, by our own juvenile state of what we call intelligence or knowledge. So if you can tell me how far the earth is from the heavens, while the scientists say that it is a fact that the earth is 93 million miles from the sun. I know I can see that far, and I don't need glasses to see that far. You understand? That's what scientists say. To understand the depth of his greatness or his place that is much more superior than ours, is in a place that the Torah would say a deer. It is a place of majesty and much more superior. That's what above is. One says on the job, well, the order came from above. Well, you know that that supplants all other directives or any other order. So the orders that came before that, that's what above is. That is the marum of the superiority of above. So it supplants, it destroys anything that came before that which came from above. So anything that we know or understand, that which is above, the degree of that, it is greater than what we know today. So he's sending us a simple truth that is from above. Hear this, what David says in Psalms Tehillim 139 and verse 6. Tehillim 139 verse 6. We must understand that he knows everything. There is nothing that he does not understand, nor does he know. And we must understand that the things that are above, that he speaks to us, they're greater than all of our collective knowledge of any matter there is. There's nothing greater than that which is from above. That we said, he said of that which is from above, Tehillim 139:6, he said, such da'at, such knowledge of discernment, such knowledge of the depths of the broadness of Yah, such knowledge, he said, it is too excellent, it is too wonderful for me. Now that's a statement. He said, this knowledge that is from above, it is too wonderful for my mind to understand, to comprehend the depths of Yah's mind speaking to me. He says that it is shagab, it is high, it is exceedingly and above our knowledge. It is so high that it is inaccessible. You can't access this through our natural prowess. It doesn't come by the prowess of our ability or intellectual stamina. It must come from above. And I want to show you how it comes, all right? I love this book. Not only do I like it, I love it. I spent a lot of time in it. I spent a lot of time. I'm not a pretender. I'm a realist. This is what gives me life to live. This is what gives me life to live. It is from this book whereby I grasp the wisdom of life, and it calls me to live. Regardless of the circumstances, I live. So I love this book. This is the lover of my heart. I love this book. Look at what he says now. He said this, for such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high, it is so high that I cannot attain to this great knowledge. I cannot comprehend the depths of it. I don't have the ability to reason the thoughts of Yah, His majesty, His superiority above all things, because He made that. Now, the reason I'm teaching this to us today, tonight, is that we began to learn how to trust our Abba and to trust a word that is so wonderful, that is so sahab, that we don't have the ability to assess it, to open the door to it. And so Yah sends the power of that revelation by what? By testimony in Yahshua HaMashiach, that we can enter in through the door of the city of Almighty Yah, Yerushalayim, which is from above, is where the city of Yah is. So he said that this knowledge is so great, the power to secure it, it is too wonderful. My mind cannot think in logistic terms of the greatness of this wonderful, exceptional knowledge. My mind cannot reason, it cannot digest that. There's a way we can't. The book tells us, and the wisdom Shlomo gives us the open door how we can assess this and draw from the great nutrients of it. Listen, Yisrael, we're not going to live by bread alone. We can sit and eat steak all day long. That's not life. We must live by not some, but by every word that proceeds, that comes out of the fifth, the mouth of Almighty Yahweh. And Yahshua is that living word. You can sit down to the finest of dining, what they call the finest of dining. I'm a student of understanding food. I like to cook. And what the world calls the greatest triangle or the triumph of the greatest food or the condiments, they're all filthy. I say, isn't that amazing? What they call the most luxurious thing, foie gras and the sturgeon, the roe that comes out of the sturgeon, the eggs. The black eggs, what are they called though? I know the name of it. Foie gras, tell me, Don. Yes, that's it. Caviar. And shark's fin. Everything that Yah says, don't touch. That's what the world calls. This is the finest of delicacy here. That's why Dawid said, feed me, Yah. And it's one thing. Until I want no more, because I can never be full of this. We have time to expend our energy in some of the greatest of follies, but there is no love for this. I'm not talking about among the world. I'm talking about among those that say they love Yah. Hallelujah. How do I assess this wisdom and the greatness of this profound truth of Almighty Yahweh, Shalom, Shlomo speaks here in the writings of the Book of Wisdom, Wisdom chapter 9. I want to read this. Hear this, Wisdom 9, verse 17. You jot this down and you look over this in your spare time. You have plenty of that. But he says this, who can understand the marvelous depths of Yah's Torah? He says, who has learned, Lamads? Who has learned, who has experience? Who can speak with certainty they have learned and has known Yada experience, the counsel of the Musa of Almighty Yahweh? Who can say, well, this book is a book of the Musa, the counsel, to correct us, to direct us, to redirect us, to change our ideas and our thoughts on life, and to refine us by defining us by whom he is. Yeshua is the example of that. He says, who has learned and has known Yah's counsel? Unless, O Mare Yahweh, give Nathan, he grants that. He bestows that unless he gives the chuchmah, the experience with him. That's what wisdom is. When one speaks of the plethora of the wisdom, they speak from the experiences in life that they have garnered, whether it be tav or ra, quote, good or evil, unquote. So they speak from a plethora, and that is a knowledge that is of broad perspective, and they speak by wisdom of their association with that matter. So they have an association with that because they have experienced that. But who has truly experienced the counsel of Yah? When he made all things. See, this stuff is from above. It is from above. It is not earthly. It is not of the blindness of our eyes that we have this this film over our eyes. But who has known or experienced the counsel of Yah unless Yah gives the man wisdom? And then it says this, and you have sent your Ruach HaKodesh from on high, from above. That's why Yahshua said, it is best for you that I go away. For if I go not away, then the Father cannot send Ruach HaKodesh. He cannot send the power of life which is his mind. That's what the Ruach is. It is not some wind that blowing out here. That's Yah's breath. When he breathes, he calls the air to circulate. And he, isn't it amazing? Because we don't have to think when we breathe, do we? You don't think when you walk. That's why most children, when they begin to walk, they fall when they try to think how to walk. But once they learn how to walk, they don't have to think how they walk at all. So this is his breath. And Yahshua said, if I go not away, then the Abba cannot send the Comforter. And so the only way we're going to have this experience with the wisdom of Yah, we must be filled with the Ruach of Yah. He is Ruach. He is life. He is spirit, if I must use that expression. So it must come by the power of the Ruach HaKodesh. We must be filled. We must be filled, and it is not some delusional thing. And most of the congregate today is not filled with the Ruach HaKodesh. You will know because Ruach always judges you. It tells you when you're a liar, a filthy, dirty thief, and it calls one to mourn in great repentance. It will tell you when your sins are wicked and filthy, when you're vile, when you're wicked, when you're insensitive to Yah's way. I may have to teach on that again. Hallelujah. I know we have many teachings on it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to speak to us as Baruch spoke unto the nation to give them great insights as to that which is above and the mind that is from above, that this mind is above all things. And when we understand that which is from above, then it causes a great delight of fatness, because we know that the resolution of all things are in his hand and is his hand. He gives us a profound statement here. I like this. Hallelujah. And Second Baruch, writing of Baruch, Second Baruch, in chapter 7, verse 1. He says this. This is the logis of what I will teach, that which is from above. He identifies with great clarity who he is as Shaul. Shaul would send the writings of the letters unto the nations. I, Shaul, a Shulish Ach of Yah, in or through the power of Yahshua HaMashiach. And so Baruch says, and I, Baruch, went away from there, from the great wisdom and the presence of the Melach of Yah, and I came to the Am, the people of Yisrael, and I assembled them. He said there was not one that was not a part of the assembly. I assembled them from the greatest to the smallest, and then I began to talk. It was no respect of person. I gathered them, I commanded them. We will gather in the Mishpat place, the place of judgment. And these are the words that he spoke. First of all, he commanded them to shemach, to hear, to open your ayin. Forget about your intelligence, your intellectual prowess of Torah, and the wisdom of the word. He says, hear, O children of Yisrael. Then he says, Oni, I want you to behold how many are left from the 12 tribes of Yisrael. How many are there that are true sons and daughters of Yisrael, of the nation? How many that truly have the seal and the power that Yah is true? You know what the seal is? Well, I'll tell you that. I do that to intimidate us, to frighten us, to see how and to show us what little love we really have for him. It's not a great love we have for him. You can pretend and lie to yourself, but it's not. Look at what the prophet says. He commands us to hear. He asked the question because his heart was moved. How many are left? As the old one would say, you look back and all those that began with me, where are they now? So how many are left of Yisrael? Then he says in verse 3, to you, and to your advance, to our fathers. No, you few that are left. He said to you, and you few, how many? And to even our fathers, hear what he says. He said, Yahweh gave. That is a very powerful word in the Hebraic, the Ethiopic, the Ugaritic. I don't care what, or even the Aramaic language, gave to Natan. To grant, to bestow, to show the favor. He said, this is what Yah did. He gave the Torah, the wisdom, his knowledge, that which is far above. He gave the Torah above all Goyim, above all the nations. He gave us a Torah which is from above. He gave us truth that was not created in the earthly realm, but it comes from above. And so Yah granted to our forefathers, he gave them a wisdom, a manner of life, a Torah above all nations. No nation that has a wisdom or a testimony like the nation of Yisrael. And if you don't have the testimony, you don't have the seal, Yisrael. You can pretend all you want to. It's more than the volume of our words. It is the power of our lives. It's the way we live, the way we walk. And it reflects who he is. Not what I am, but who he is. So he gave us a Torah that is from above. I like that. It is so powerful that he called Moshe up in the high place. And he took the pen of his hand, and on stones, as our hearts are represented, the stony heart, and he wrote that which is from above. He wrote on that, and he granted that to us that we may have that. You will know whether your mind operates in that which is from above. It is a sure sign. There is one sure seal. I don't care how folks talk. I listen to people and I hear their words. I don't understand the power of words. I listen to them. Well, you don't listen. You just don't know how well I listen to what people say. It doesn't get past me at all. But here is a profound prophecy of a statement by Yohanan or Yahachanan in the writings of John. I like this. I love the book, but this I do like. It says in John chapter 3, verse 31. This is only a sure seal that shows the nations that we have that which is above and even above them. And this is what the prophet says here in John 3, 31. He said, I want you to understand that he that enters in, or bow, he that comes, he says, he comes from. He gives us the designation as his origin, the origination, the origin where it began. He comes from above, and he says he is above too. It's almost like the boss man, he's above everyone. I don't care what the supervisor says, but when the boss man, when the chief man, when the CEO steps in, I would watch that at IBM. We had the president of IBM Charlotte. His name was Herb Watkins. He was blacker than this man, regal, and he was a beautifully symmetric man and dressed so sharp, and I liked the man. I liked talking with him, very bright and intelligent. It didn't make no difference who you were, whatever your ethnicity was. When that tall black man walked through that building, everything got quiet. You understand? Because they knew that his office was not down beneath. His office was above all the offices. And that's a fact. Yisrael, amen. That's a fact. Hear this. He that comes from above is above. He is Marown. He is above. He is the most noble one. He is the most superior one. His superiority supersedes anything that we think that we possess. He comes from above. And then he lets us know, just like Baruch said, that he gave us a Torah above all nations. His words are above all. I don't care what your philosophy is. I don't care what your concept of life is. This book is above all that. This book is the master of all of that. It says that he is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly. You that are natural and carnal have been made out of the dust and the dirt of the earth, for the clay. You're earthly. You mind the things that are earthly. And he says, not only that, but you talk, you ama, you speak, you utter those things that are earthly. He said, but I want to give you a new focus. The one that is from above, from the heavens above, beyond the heavens or the heights that you can imagine. He that comes from above the heavens, he is above. He is above all. That's the power of his great majesty and the strength of his words. They're above all words. This book, he gave this to our forefathers, that the words of this book is above all the words that are earthly. And those concepts that originated in this clay vessel, and the only reason they originated because that was the denier of one of the most important factors upon the face of the Olam Yisrael. They don't have the testimony. Hallelujah. And what he has seen, hope, Yeshua. He has seen. He doesn't talk from anything that he has not seen. What he has seen and what he has, as Granny would say, heard. What he has heard. What he has listened to. What he has been faithful to obey. That, see, he testified. We don't testify the things that we have learned, the truth, heard. We don't testify that. Listen to your conversation and see what you testify of. You testify the things you have learned that are earthly and that are carnal and that are non-productive. But he that, he says, those things he has seen, so he knows, and those things he has heard, so that he testified. And because the testimony is so inaccessible to the earthly ones, we don't believe. He says, and no man receive his testimony, his either. We don't receive the testimony. They would challenge the very birth of Yeshua, HaMashiach, because the knowledge of that is inaccessible to the natural mind of a man and their philosophy. That there is a heavens above the heavens, that there is a kingdom, that the natural mind cannot assess that. So that natural mind is sold unto the earthly things. You're always, you're not desiring the things that are great and full of majesty. We want things that are trinkets and small and have no value. I don't want that. I want to work out my nefesh, Yoshach, with Yira and Yare, with fear and trembling. I want to know, as the old one would say, I want to know that I know. I'm ready to die. I'm ready to die, that I know that I'm right. He is from above, with earthly. He testified only the things he has seen, he has heard. He testified that, and no man, we don't even receive the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach. Come on, Yisrael. I know in our grandizing arrogance, we will say, well, I do. Well, let's think how we willingly sin and defy the very order of Yah. Let's think how we do that. So don't set yourself on a pedestal, this loftiness, and think that you have something that is superior to someone, because you don't have a damn thing. Without the power of this testimony, you have nothing. And this testimony should be in our hearts day and night, in our minds. We speak it, we testify of it, in our walk and our talk. But tell me what you're talking about. He that, see, this testimony is from above. He that receives, acknowledge, allow it to inhabit their minds and their hearts, they embrace it. He that receive his, Yeshua's testimony, has received the seal that Yah is true. You don't even know if he's true unless you have this testimony. This testimony comes from above. You can pretend all you want to. You can pray all you want to. You're going to die that way. And in hell, not you all. In hell, you're going to lift your eyes. You don't have to buy it. When you have that testimony, that's why it's vital. That's why Baruch asked, where are all the people of Israel? Where is the two remnant of Israel? Tell me, please. Where are they? This is a foolish generation. And they're void of the power of this testimony, because this testimony came from above. It is the wisdom of Yah. How does he do it? You don't understand the depths of that. You can try to figure it out. You can't figure it out. He came. The power of his Torah was made bara. Only Yah can create, made flesh. And he calls the vessel of Miriam clean. She was a Beth Ula. I don't care what men say. I don't care the creative forms of their vile, wicked, damnable gods. He came. See, that testimony is powerful. It defies the logics of a man's mind. It is from above. It is not earthly. See, when we are beneath it, because we have this, the Torah used the word Evelech, when one is blind, when one cannot see. Our minds and our hearts are blind. So that's why I don't know about that. How do you reason with that which is from above when your mind is not even a first grade mind? How do you articulate with a chemist that talk in terminology or a mathematician that you don't even know what the numeric structure really is? This is how stupid we have become and how silly we have become. This is how ignorant man is. That is the only true seer. Where he seer me, baby, honey, girl, quote, with the Holy Ghost and with fire, unquote. You're a silly old woman and you're an immature man. This is the true seer. This is it here. This is how you know you have received that which has come from above. You have the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. You can, as they would say, test a lie, but it's not the testimony. We testify. We testify. Well, let me proceed. I will show you how we do that. Let me read this quickly here. In the book of Hanukkah, the dedicated one, Hanukkah, chapter 32, one verse I want to read. As he was there in this great place of wisdom, Hanukkah 32, verse 3. I want to read this. Hallelujah. He said, and I came to the garden of Zadik, the righteousness. And the word Zadik, Sadakha, it means simply the character and the beauty of Yah's excellent, his personality. He came to the garden of righteousness. Now the words above, it implies it is beyond. It is inaccessible to the natural mind of man. It's beyond the thought process of man, the words or the knowledge of Yah's Torah. It is beyond the ability for man to reason or to understand the concept of it. That's why you have so many splinters and so many different groups out here today. Why? Because they really don't have the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach, because that testimony is from above. He gives that. He grants that. He gives gifts unto men. Now he says this. He says, and I saw above or beyond, higher. I'm going to do a teaching on the very elect. Things that I learn daily and I sit. I realize just how ignorant I am. I'm going to make this statement before I proceed. I want to finish this tonight. Not just the initial process of that teaching. I have probably 15, 16 pages of scripture, hour after hour of studying. And so when I finish, I probably have 40 pages of scripture. I'm not talking about notes that I take. Scripture. That must witness to what is written in the book. We must have a witness. It is a protracted teaching that it's going to take time, and one must have the ability to hear, to understand. And it will open up a realm of understanding you have, because I didn't have it. You have never had. That's why we must understand what the book says and love it. And the prophet speaks, he saw above. He saw Marown, beyond those trees, many other larger ones growing there. He talks about the fragrance of those trees. He said it was sweet, very precious, large ones, and they had much seed. They were beyond. They had much nobility. They were elegant. They were beautiful, their stature, their symmetry, and every branch was formed right. He said they were elegant, and they were very beautiful, they were splendid. And then he talks about one tree that was above all of them. He talks about, and the tree of wisdom, the Ezrat, the tree of life. You're sure, I saw the tree of wisdom, of which one eats, one must eat. One must eat the bread, the lechem, this book of wisdom. One eats and knows great wisdom was among them, and Yahshua is that great tree of life. In the midst of all of that, above all the splendor and the beauty and the fragrance of all the trees, he saw one that was the consummate of wisdom, that he eats and he dines and he lives on the wisdom of Torah. That's why he gave us a book above all goyim, the goyim, all nations, Yisrael. He gave us a jewel above all nations. He gave us the jewels of his mind. It is something sick in our damnable, twisted minds when we don't realize the greatness of our Abba. And to offer unto him just a simple todah of his great excellence that he granted. I'm not just talking about here. I'm talking about our lives represent the power of that. I've never seen so many superficial people in all of my life. It's difficult to find someone that is genuine. I don't care whether it's man, woman, husband, wife, children. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You don't find that today. You find those that are full of pretense and false. I had a man to write me the other day, I said, your problem, you're hard-headed, you're wicked, you're stubborn, you listen to nobody, and don't waste my time. Well, others would say, well, you know, you don't talk. No, I said, don't waste my time. You're taking away my time from those that, at least they're trying. You got an excuse for everything. Don't waste my time. You're stubborn, you're hard-headed, you're immature. That's your problem. You're a little boy. You don't know the definitive of a man. Hallelujah. What are you, preacher? Well, I'll let you figure that one out. Hear this, Yisrael. I want to go back to John, the writings of Yochanan, or Yochanan, Yochanan. John chapter 8. Now I said here in John chapter 3, verse 33, he that received the testimony of Yahshua has received the seal that Yah is true. That's what it says, doesn't it? See, every scripture, we must have line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, here, there a little. We must have the fullness of Torah. And the reason we must have that, Yahshua spoke that because we're so wicked. That's the way Yah gives it to us. We have to have that. We just can't read in a chronological sequence. From day one as a young man, in all my ignorance, Yah taught me. I didn't learn that from any man. Evander Hertzfeld didn't teach me that because he was one that was chronological. He read in a chronological process. I could never do that. I don't know how people do that. That's why I've never been able. Well, I've read the scripture over 3 or 4 times. Well, I've never read it, but I've read it hundreds of times. But I've never read it like a fictitious book and starting Bereshit and ending up in Gilead. That's not how the book is read. You must search this out. But look at this here. Now, Yah is true if we have the testimony of Yahshua. It says in John 8:21, this is Yahshua and his great disclosure against those that were the Pharisaic mindset that thought they were bright. And everyone today think that he or she is bright. Nothing more sickening than when women call themselves. I would tell a woman, shut your wicked mouth. Don't see me. Don't even talk to me. At least I would give you I would oblige you by saying bye. I will not waste my time with this foolish, ignorant generation. Look what Yahshua says in John 8:21. Then said Yahshua again to them, he said, I go my way. And you're going to seek me. You shall seek me. You shall desire me. And then he said, you shall die in your sins. See, when I tell us that, we get upset. The way you are, you're going to die that way. The way you sit here right now, that's the way you're going to die. That's a fact. He that is often reproved, harden his heart. Suddenly destruction comes, and that is without warning. You know that God speaks of your ills and your wickedness. And you don't take heed. You're going to die that way. Listen now. He said you're going to die in your sins. Why? Where I go, you cannot. He did not say maybe, but there is an affirmation of a confirmed statement with an affirmative. He said, he did not say you can maybe. He said you cannot. No! You cannot go. You cannot come. So the Yehudim, they said, well, will he kill himself? Because he says, where I go, you cannot come. And he said to them, you see, we don't understand. He says, you are you are from beneath. You have this gloss over your eyes, this film that your eye is not open. You can't see. You have such lust. You have such world inspiration and admiration, aspiration. You can't even see. He says, you are from beneath. He said, I am from above. You love those things that are sensual. You, the other, your mind is glossed over with every kind of sin of unrepentance. There's no love for you. He said, you are from beneath, but I want to let you know of a certainty. Yeah? I am from above. I am from above. I am from above. You are of this world. I am not of this world. Need a man that says that he loves Yah, loves this world, then the love of Yah is not. I don't care who you are. You can pretend. You can walk a pretentious walk and false walk. But it will merit you nothing at all. Hallelujah. Then he says in verse 24, again now, I said therefore to you, you shall die, you shall muth, you shall mavith, you shall die prematurely before your time. You shall die in your hata, your sins, your corruption. Y'all stop playing with this wicked world. You shall. Again, a confirmation. Why? Why? He says, you shall die in your sins. For if you believe not that I am he says, you shall die in your sins. Again, he says in John 3:33, he that received his testimony has received the seal that Yah is true. That seal has to come from above. You don't get that at the nickel dime shop. You don't get that at the Sunday whole house. You don't get that at the Shabbat whole house where they pretend. You don't get that there. You must read from the book of wisdom, Yisrael. You must read the wisdom of Israel. That one of the seven Rechem of Yah. It comes from above. James said that the wisdom that is beneath it, it is sensual, it's devilish and earthly. But the wisdom that comes from above, first of all, is pure. You know it's pure. We must be gadol as he is chodash. We must be pure. That's why we must have that mind. As Shaul says, let the same mind, let that same mind that was in Yeshua HaMashiach, it must be in us. We can pretend and we think that we have the knowledge of the things that are of this book. He was talking to those that were learned men. Men that were students of Torah, men that could quote every word from Bereshit to Melchiah. They could quote it all because Yochanan was not written at that time. They knew the book. They were laborers. They could write it. They could quote it precisely. They labored in the Torah. But they did not see that tree that Hanukkah saw. That was the beauty of, he was above all the trees. He is the wisdom of Yah. We can pretend and keep going our way. We're going to die that way. We don't have the testimony that you're sure. That testimony which is above and that he is true. We don't have the seal that Almighty Yahweh is true. You can say what you want to. I don't care about your religious fervor and how you feel. It doesn't mean a damn thing. You're going to die that way. And these men had the most excellence of religious fervor. They were knowledgeable men. And that's a fact, but they did not know him. Nor did they know the power of that testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach. Yochanan did not come to work the mighty miracles. He came to testify that that one that's coming after me, he is mightier than me. That I'm not even worthy enough to tie the latches or string up his shoes. I'm not even worthy to do that. And what makes us think that we can sit in the abode of Yah in his presence? That he is far above us. You go before the boss man, you tremble. He calls you in the office. You don't know what it's about. You get scared. You come before Yah with sin permeating in your mind, and there is no fear. Your filth dress you. I'm going to die in Him. I have nothing to live for but Him. I don't need no money. You know, when I sit with Joachim, at time I'm always testing fine daughter. I said to him, I told him exactly what came in this week. I said, now what if I took half of that? Or get the generous gifts that some of the Achim get. I would have a lot of money, but I can't do that. I know what it takes. I know what is important. I know what is of value. I know that. You understand? So it's not about that. All that I need is in Yeshua HaMashiach. I don't know the way you know it, Mama. He supplies strength, He grants unto me. Life would be worthless without Yeshua. All things in Yeshua I find. This is a sad generation to think you're going to find joy and shalom and peace and fun in the world. Moshe, in the book of Ibram, he chose rather to suffer with the people of Yah than to enjoy the pleasure of sin. For a moment, you're going to die. I don't care how young and how strong you think you are, how virile, and how pretty you may think you are, honey girl, you're going to die. And without the testimony, you're going to die in your wickedness. It got to come from above. It is not something you learn here sensually. That's why there's very little love today. Men don't know how to love their wives, and wives don't know how to love their husbands. You don't. It's one thing about love when you would see people together. You could sense that. I could. I've always been cognitive of things, and the reason I have, because I've always been deserved. I don't have to ask questions. I just look at things. I can look at things and understand. I just watch the process of the flow. You don't see that today. You don't find it. Because it is a delusion. It is not the mind of Yeshua HaMashiach. Can I read a little farther? Well, I shall. I want to show you the confidence of Yeshua that He grants unto us, even in the death of condemnation, in John chapter 19, verse 7. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It says, then the Yahudim, they answer Pilate. Now, this is what they said. We have a Torah. John 19, 7. That's what it says, right? We have a Torah. Now, let's go back. I read to us what I began in the book of Wisdom 9:17. Who has learned, has known Yah's counsel? There's only one thing that teach us the counsel of Yah. Unless you give wisdom and send your Ruach HaKadosh on high. That's what it said. Now Baruch, the Jews, the Yahudim, said, we have a Torah. Second Baruch 77:3 says, to you and your Avad Yah gave the Torah above all nations. We must draw it all together. Those of Yehuda, they said, we have a Torah. This man has defiled, and he has assaulted the Torah of Yah. He is the Torah. That's our testimony, that the power of the Torah is real, and it lives in us. And we have power over sin. We don't have to defy the Torah of Yah and bring forth this vile stench of sin, of iniquity. That is so perverse and wicked. We have no sensitivity to the body of Yeshua HaMashiach. They said, Pilate, kill him. Kill him. We have a Torah, and by our Torah, he ought to die. You see, Yeshua is the Torah. That's why he said you're going to die in your sins, because you don't have the testimony. I just read that. Hallelujah. I'm a student. See, I'm not a master. You all can be masters. I'm a student. I'd rather die a student than a master. Because you can always teach a student. A master, you can never teach him. I have mastered nothing. Haven't even mastered the skill of being a student. He says that they said that our Torah says he ought to die. Well, Yeshua did speak the Torah. He said you're going to die in your sins, did he not? I'm from above and you're from beneath.
So, because he made himself to be the son of Yah. When Pilate therefore heard the saying, he was more afraid. He said, this, notice that it's so inaccessible. I have the wisest of counselors. I have the men of the east. I have the philosophers. I know every god there is to know. And this man declared that he is the one that he sits at the throne of the great creator. Made him afraid. He was fearful. And what? And he went again to the Mishpat Hall. He took him to the judgment hall and said to Yahshua, look at the question he asked him. Where are you from? Where are you from? Where are we from? He said, where are you from? But Yahshua gave him no answer. He didn't even respond to the dog. Then said Pilate to him, you don't even speak to me. He said, listen, man, don't you know not that I have power to destroy, to impel, to bring you down to the chambers of death? Don't you know I have power to impel you? And also got the power to release you. I'm glad that the commands come from above. Yahshua says to that fool. Then he answered. He said, you could have no power at all against me, except, again the word nathan, except it was given from above. See, that command come from above. I like that. I'm so simple. I love this simple truth. He said, you can do nothing. That's why no weapon, there's nothing the world can do against me. Every command comes from above. Every order comes from above. He said, there is nothing you can do. He said, the command has come from above. And that's all right, because I'm here to do the will of my Abba. I'm here to do his will. So whatever the command is, it must come from above, because we are the Sugula, the people that he has set aside above all nations, given us a wisdom of Torah that is above all the philosophical books that have been written by man against the Dalai Lama and all of the fools, Allah and Farrakhan and all of them. He has given us a book and a wisdom that is greater than all of that. And that wisdom is revealed through one simple power, and that is the testimony of Yahshua. Because you know that Yah is true, and he sits high above, and he looks low, Yisrael. He looks down on us. He said, you can do nothing with me. The command came from my father. It came from above. Now, you would think that if the fool had sense, but Yah did not intend to open his mind. That's why Yahshua said, you're going to die the way you are. You're going to die in your sin. We can pretend all we want to. And said, well, I'm going to pray for them. No, I'm not praying for one of them. Yahshua said, you're going to die in your corruption and in your sins. Now, listen to this now. Hallelujah. You have no power except it was given to you from above. Therefore, he that delivered me to you has a greater sin. You that turn your backs on, you turn your backs on the testimony. Your sin is greater than those that impel him. Your sins are greater than the Pilate's sin. And people think that they're getting by, that you began to trickulate back to the ways of the things that are beneath, and you forget about the things that are above, that your sins don't trouble you. Something is sick in your twisted mind, Yisrael. When Yah is not even cognate in your thought process, he is not the one that keeps your mind straight and attentive unto the things of the book, that you don't even pick it up. You are a sick beast. You're not even a sick beast. You're going to die that way in your corruptions and your sin, because he's the one that sits high. He sits above and he looks lower. I'm so glad. This is my confidence that there's nothing that the world or the enemy can do against me. Why? Because the commands come from above. They come from above. I'm so glad that he is in control. That's all right by me. That's all right. May not be all right by you, but it's all right by me. The commands come from above. He raised up the greatest of the hosts against his nation. He said to Pharaoh, for this purpose, I've raised you up. I've caused you to room, to be exalted, to be lifted up, to be esteemed. that I may get my esteem, my great honor, my splendor upon you. I'm going to bring you down. I'm going to bring you down. And he allowed the tentacles of hell to rise up in the place high above. And he cast them down because his name is going to be the ultimate resolution of all things. And every man is going to call upon that name. And that's a fact, Yisrael. That's why we must birth. We must be born by the power of our mother. Shaul said, he writes in the Galusha and says that the true Yerushalayim, it is from above. And it's free. That is the mother of all. Let's keep our hearts and our minds on Yah, Yisrael. We that are sensual, we mind earthly things. That's all our mind is on, earthly things. We must, I don't care what no one says, when you find men and women that don't like to pray, something is twisted in their minds, you understand? I don't care if it's a form of prayer, if it's formalism, it's right to do it because it disciplines one's to press even beyond that urging of one's flesh to not to do it. And Shaul writes unto Ephesians, he writes to them to encourage them. And that's why no man you're not praying, man, you have no revelation from Yah. You can say what you want to. But a man doesn't like to pray, he has no revelation. He may talk and read a few scriptures and think he has knowledge, but that's not knowledge of Torah. What a man has, he has the discernment. He has the wisdom of that matter that you see reflective in his life. Listen to this. Shaul says here in Ephesians chapter 1. And he gives us a great inspiration to let us know that we should always pray and always strive to pray. Ephesians chapter 1. Because of the great tikvah, the great promises that we have in the Torah of Almighty Yah. And then we should have a great regard for those things that are above, that we have an inheritance that is above. And we should appreciate that from Almighty Yah. And then when we began to understand those things in the simplicity of his form, then we will understand the depths of the powerful nature of our Abba and how high he sits and how far above he is. Above us. So he writes here as he began the process of this letter in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19. He gives us great consolation. And he says, and what is the exceeding or the abundance or the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe now? That's why Yahshua said, he that has the testimony Yochanan of Yahshua has the seal that Yah is true. That Yah is true. So his great power toward us that believe, according to the working of his power or his mighty power. Then he says, which, see, there's nothing greater than this. See, the might of his powers, they were wrought. He worked them in Yahshua HaMashiach. Well, what did he do? When he raised him from the dead. When he raised him from the dead. These liars today say they're praying and they're raising men from the dead, but they are flat out liars. You're not raising a damn thing in Jesus' name. That's a fact. They're not raising no one from the dead. They're liars. This is the mighty work of Yah. And we see the extent of that with the Shilisha, as they went forth into the nation because there were those who had not heard or seen the power of his greatness. And because we have seen the power of that, we have a work that is greater than what they did. Because what is that? We believe. We believe without seeing. We don't have to see a physical miracle, but yet we have the power to lay hand on the sick. We just believe. For him I live, for him I die. If I die, if I live, it makes no difference at all. It is the same. It is the blessed assurance, Israel. These liars out here say they're raising that they're flat out wicked liars. He did a mighty work that he raised Yahshua from the dead. Hear this now. He raised him from the dead and set him. He set Yahshua. He established him at his right hand in the heavenly place. And what did he do? That's why no powers, no weapons, or any such thing against us shall prosper. And he says, at his right place in the heavenly place. And look at where he placed him, far above. See, we are far above the powers and the principalities. Why? Because we're the body of Yahshua HaMashiach. Far above the powers and the princes of the darkness of this world. Above the principalities and the powers and might and dominions and the ruling spirits of powers. And every name that is named, there is not one other name. It is not equivalent to Jesus, the Lord of God. And every name that is named, not only in this world, Yisrael, but also in that which is to come. That's why Yah is the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. Therefore, we sons of Jacob, he doesn't kill us all, because we all deserve death. We don't deserve the precious testimony of the life of Yahshua HaMashiach. He looked down and said, this is my beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased. Now you ask your question, are you well pleased with you? Well, I'm not. You can pretend all you want to, lock a hypocrite. Yes, not pleased. But he has wrought. I like the way they say that. Wrought. He has worked all things. The death, the resurrection of Yahshua, that we may have the true seal and that testimony. For Yahshua we live, and we die in him. And that's just the truth. He had placed him far above all the principalities and powers and might. For what reason? He has put all things, he has granted all things to be put under his feet. And he gave him to be the Rosh. You hear that? The head. Because in that head is the mind. And in that mind is from above. He gave him to be the head over all things to the congregation. You have no knowledge of Yah's truth without Yahshua, and it coming from the head. And I don't care what you Jezebelites, you Isabel say, he made Yah. He bara Yahshua, and he is the head of Yahshua, and Yahshua is the head of man, and man is the head of woman. That doesn't mean he abuses her. That doesn't mean he does her wrong, but he is the head. So not any of you Jezebels, you can forget that. Don't try to rebuke me. I get it from them. So I rebuke them now so they don't write me. You understand? As I tell one the other day, I don't have time to talk to you for no hour. I've got work to do. Come here and work, woman. We'll tell you the story of life. I don't want to hear the history of your life. I don't have time for that. You may. I don't have it. And I'm not going to sit around and listen. That was hard work yesterday, man. Talk to me. That was hard. I wanted to eat when I went home last night. I didn't have nothing to eat. I got to get me a little pantry and stock me some stuff. How about that? No, I can't do that. I'll mess up if I do that. That's all right. Hear this. Hallelujah. So understanding this great revelation that Shaul just gave us, he tells us in chapter 3 what we should do and the power of our great one. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now we know who does this. Now to him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly, above, exceedingly abundantly, above, because he is above. So whatever he does is exceedingly abundant. Here to him that all that we can ask or think, there's nothing you can ask Yah that he is not able to do, and beyond that expectation, or whatever you think. What if I had my own island in the sea? Well, he knows that if you had that, you would be more corrupt than you are now. He's able to do all of that which is above our mental concept of what he's able to do. According to the power that works. See, that same power, it operates, it asa. What does it asa? It works, it fashions us to trust him and to be faithful toward him. That works in us to him we should give great kabod, we should give honor and splendor to him be honor and splendor in the Israelite congregation. That is what the splendor, our actions, our ways, the way our minds are dressed should give him great honor and great splendor among the congregation. Why? How? By Yahshua HaMashiach throughout all ages. Throughout all ages. For what reason? World without end. Amen. 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 Now, when we understand the greatness of what he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think. Now, that we can't even fathom that. You think your little circumstances beyond the power of his ability to resolve that? We get the testimony of Yahshua. Yahshua had that testimony that Yah was true and faithful. That's why we was able to go down to the grave. We can lay down all things once we get that true testimony. Until we get that, we will always look back to the world. There's nothing there. I said to this ark yesterday, tell me, you and your wife out there, what are you going to do? I said, you like to do a little fishing. She may not. She's at mama's house. I said, eventually you're going to go back and do some of the things we did. We all going to do that. I said, then what are you going to do? Do a little fishing. You got a little income coming in. May have to do a little hustling on the side. Yeah. Go to Walmart. Go to thrift store. I say, that gets boring. And I began to explain to him, I said, I want to show you how some of my days were a day in general. When I quit IBM, I just walked out one day. If no one had any work for me to do around their houses, I would do repairs on houses, and go to their homes, and gardening. I would do that. Paint. Whatever you had me to do, I would do it. And I said, I would get up in the morning, roughly, and I would probably go walk 5 miles that morning. Come back, take a shower, go down to the tabernacle, sit in the office. I didn't have all the accommodations like I have now. Break out my concordance. I would study for an hour or two. And then I had an old stationary bicycle with one of those flywheels in the back. 100 degrees back then. I would go back there, and I'd ride that thing 25 miles almost every day. This was my daily activity. I get off of that. I change clothes back there. Come back to the tabernacle. Sit in the office. Then I go across the street to Wade's place if it was open. Maybe clean up a little bit. Stand there, talk a little bit. And I go home. I go home. And then I'll probably eat my breakfast at around 1 or maybe 2. Dinner and all in one swap. Then I will work the garden a little bit or whatever that was. I go outside and exercise a little bit. And then maybe I go visit Brother Fred. I go there for 15 minutes. I'm going, Fred, bye. I'm ready to go home and go back home. And those were my daily days. And most of the times in the evening, we walk 5 miles in the morning, we walk 5 miles in the evening. So we would do that every day. Tell me. I said, every now and then we go to TJ Maxx. What are you going to do? I have a sure assignment here. I can work. I can eat well. And I do. Fact. There's nothing in this world that no one kids you. Now, those can't stand the heat, so they sit up in the house all day with air conditioning on. That's just the truth. Hallelujah. Could I give us a great consolation? We must be reminded of his power, his greatness. Once we do that, then we will begin to see the rewards. Hear this in Ephesians 4:4. He lets us know, shall there's only Icha, there's only one body, and one Ruach. Even as you are called in one Tzikva, or one promise of your calling. There's only one Yahshua, one Imona, one faith, and one Mikva, one immersing, just one. One Almighty Yah, our Abba. He is one. Now look where he sits. Who is above all? Did he not place Yahshua above all principalities and powers and above all things of the congregation of Yisrael? He is above all. See, that's the power of the testimony, that the seal that Yah is true. We don't have Yahshua's testimony. That's why we can't receive the things that are above. We don't look for the things that are above. That's why we're constantly beneath. That's why we're always our minds have this film of blindness. We let the smallest of things blind us. I don't find no fun. The only thing I found somewhat aesthetic is that I would go to the bookstore. That was the time they had a bookstore back then. I would buy books. I love reading. I don't read like I used to, but I love buying books. I would go to the bookstore and just sit there for hours and read books. I love to read, but I don't like reading now. I like studying the Torah, because those books profit me nothing. They have no value. That doesn't make you smart because you're dumb. Wisdom comes from above, not from some earthly stupid mind to write some kind of historical facts. It doesn't make you someone that you got something you think I like to read. It doesn't mean a dumb thing. It is of no value. I like to study Lahak, to show myself approved unto Yah as a workman, need not to be ashamed. Now that I love to do. I like to study this book. I like to study this book. Hallelujah. Hear this. I want you to hear this as we close here. Hallelujah. Yah is for above all and through all, and he is in us all. These are words of great consolation as I close here. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9. Philippians. It says in Philippians 2, now wherefore Yah also has highly exalted Yahshua HaMashiach, him. He has given him a name above every name. There's no other name can replace that name. That name is above every name. That name did not come from the earth. It came from above, Yisrael. It came from that name is above every name. His name. That is our consolation. That's why we know that we have this testimony of Yahshua that his name is true, because Almighty Yahweh is true. And once we get the power of that name and the truth of that name, this is the certainty for us that we will exude ourselves and exalt one another for one thing, and that is to have the heavenly consciousness in our mind be set here. Colossians 3 and verse 1. If we have died, you then be risen with Yahshua HaMashiach, it says, seek the things which are above. And we have the testimony of Yahshua. Our mind is on the things that are above. Colossians 3:1, if you then be risen with Yahshua HaMashiach, seek those things which are above, where Yahshua HaMashiach sits on the right hand of Almighty Yah. You know that's insane. You know he sits right there, and you seek something that is beneath and sensual. If we have been risen with him, if we have the testimony, if we don't, we're going to die in our sins. Then we must set our minds on things that are above. Then he tells us this in the next verse. Set your affection on the things above. Those things that are from above. We should love those things. Set our love for the things of Yah. Set our mind on the things of the Torah, because it is a book that is above all. That's where our affection, our love shall be above, on the things that are above, and not on the things that are beneath. We should not have this love for these things that are earthly and sensual. But if I had my own big house and my own car, you're going to die. There are folks die in million-dollar houses. You're not taking one thing with you. You're going to die. You're going to die. And when you die, those that you think you love, you will be forgotten. I'm working on the graves out here. I'm going to get them right. Get that beautiful, because it should be that way. It should be accessible. It should be a beautiful place. And when others come, the world does that. And Yah commands us, we should make sure it is done right. And it's the upkeep and all of those things. I said to one, it's amazing how the world will upkeep things like that. And the people of Yah, we have no conscience of that, because our mind is not on the things of Yah. We're greedy, we're selfish. It's all about me and what's for me. Hear this, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Colossians, in the 14th verse of the same chapter, Colossians. After we have set our minds on those things that are above, this is what we should do. Above all that, he says, and above all these things, we must put on. You have to dress. You get up sometime in the morning, you're moody, aren't you? See, love is from above, because Yah is love. No. He is love. He is Ahava. So he is above, isn't he? So he commands us, and above all these things, put on Ahava. Put on this affection. Put on love kindness. We as a people, we don't know how to be loving and kind. Most women today think some kind of sensual desires that's loving and that's stupid. Dogs don't love each other. They're bull. That's not love. Love is a true affection that is beyond. It is so full of shalom. It is so aesthetically pleasing. That's what love is. You love him. You sure? Well, I saw him take a little paddle and pop his head back there and say, get it right, boy. Because he was. I saw him pop his head. Pat. But we don't call that love. Because we're dumb. We got this damn superstitious, superficial, false thing we call love. The world taught you how to love. World made you a whole woman. You done every kind of filthy thing. Made you an effeminate thing, man. We call that love. But you don't know how to. You don't even know what love is, woman. Silly self. I'm a man. How about that? So we got, as the whores turn, as the world turn, they have taught us love. It's some wicked activity. You tell me you know how to love. You don't even know Yah. You're as silly as they come. Don't come to me that way. Love is something that the more beauty, it intensifies as you just get a little older. That's all right. I like that. I like that. We must put on love. Above all things, we must put on love. Hallelujah. The most purest of all gifts, his truth. James, Yahoo 1:16. I want to read these four passages in. Two in James and two in Peter. Listen to this. James 1:6. He commands us, 1:16, James, Yahoo 1:16. Don't sin. James 1:16. Do not err, my beloved, Yisrael. Yisrael, Yalai, Achim. Don't err, daughters. Don't cause your mind to be given to error and falsehood and deception. James 1:16, verse 17. This is what he says. Every tough gift. Man, if you're a tough gift for your wife, wife, you're a tough gift. Every tough gift and every torment perfect gift is from above. That's where it comes from. Everything that is complete, and we're complete in Yeshua, every tough gift, every perfect gift, it comes from above. And it comes down from the Father of lights, of Ma'or, of rejoicing, of Torah, in whom there is no chance, no variableness, no change, and neither shadows of turning. Yah's not going to change for you. He's not going to change nothing for you. The order is already set. You're not the prima donna. You're not some kind of gift to the world, man. Fact of the matter. So you don't know how to love. That's why he says, put it on. You get up like a fruitcake. Put out some love in the morning. You get up nutty, nutty and crazy. So put it on. Put it on. I'm nutty, so let me dress up in love. I got you. You put it on. Just like you put on your shoes. You dress yourself. Man, woman, what the? Now dress yourself up. Put it on. Put it on. It's a tough gift. It's perfect. Just like you put on that nuttiness. I don't know what I'm saying. If that's all right. It's there. It's from above. That's all right. That's why I don't have too many friends. That's all right. I don't care. So you put it on. You put your shoes on. You put a little love on. And get yourself frock on, as they were calling the days your frock. You call them, put your frock on. You get a little more love, a little more cheerful, a little more joy. Just put it on. How about that? And then when you do all that, you'll understand this last two verses. This is why we need to be very cognizant and conscious of me. And that's why prayerfulness should be One of the most important things we do, 1 Peter 4:7. If we believe this, but the end of all things is at hand. Do we believe that? Don't answer me. He says we're in the Acharich, in the Chetz, the end, when it's all, the end of all things is at hand. So he tells us to be sober and watch and look forward to prayer. Watch to pray. Watch to bela, to pray. Why? He says, and above all things, have fervent love, ahava, among yourselves. For ahava shall cover the multitude of sin. What? So you're easy to forgive one another. Yah is love, isn't he? So he is going to cover all of our sins. Your sins are no lesser, no greater than anyone else, but they're great because they're against the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. Put on the things that are from above and undress yourself from the things that are from beneath. May the riches of Yah rest upon you all. May strength fill your heart. I intend to go that long, but may he strengthen us all. Cause our hearts to delight in the blessings of Yahshua HaMashiach. Bless you all, Yisrael, you that have joined us for Chitvei Imat. We greet you in Yahshua's mighty name. May this simple truth be a rich blessing to you and your house. Let us stand to our feet. Hallelujah. As Granny would say, let us stand on our feet here. Hallelujah. And turn toward Yerushalayim. For your blessings are great and mighty. We told you for all things. Bless your house, your people. We brach you for Yerushalayim, which is from above, and it is free. Keep us all, we do ask, in Yahshua's name, heal us all, every circumstance. We do pray, for the shalom of Yerushalayim, your people scattered abroad, toda for this day. And as the old one would say, if you grant us to rise in the morning, we shall praise you. Hallelujah. 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 Yabrach Yisrael.